here to tell you, my church, don't you get discouraged, but you keep trusting God, realizing if I've got God making up my hedge and filling my gap, the enemy can't touch me. You may think he's got you, but friend, if he's got you, then you better watch out. He's never will get you, because he never will catch you, because you're hidden in God's sight, and God will protect his church. Well, I'm trying to preach tonight. Amen to God. I thank God that God stands between me and my enemy, me and the devil. Amen to God. I don't want to sin that breaks that gap, but I want to keep God as my closest friend. God as my closest fighter. God as my closest, amen to God, companion. Psalms 91 and 1 through 12. Listen to this. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver me from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. I'm here to tell you that devil will catch you in his snares if you'll let him catch you. But I'm glad that I've trusted in my refuge, in my fortress, in my high tower. He will deliver me from every snare the devil has put in front of you and in front of me. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Praise God. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrows that fly by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. I'm here to tell you, Jessica, God is standing between you and your enemy. Amen. I hope you don't mind me telling us. The other day, she come walking down the hall crying, and I said, Jessica, what's wrong? She said, I just been a praying, Daddy. And I said, what's wrong? I could tell she was troubled. She said, sometimes I feel like God's left me and I just can't seem like I'm getting nowhere. I said, I promise you, honey, God hadn't left you. Amen. God's standing between you and your devil. I'm here to tell you, he's your gap filler, Jessica. He's between you and your enemy. And when the devil makes you think God's not with you, that's when he's picking you up and he's a carrying you. Praise God. He said he will never leave us, nor will he forsake us, but he'll go with us even to the end of the world. I said, honey, have you sinned and done anything against God? She said, no, Daddy, I haven't sinned. I just feel like I'm a fighting hell, fighting the devil. I said, I promise you, friend, God is with you, babe. He'll be with you to your last day. He's with us to the end of the world, and he never will forsake us. I said, learn, my friend, we gotta learn to walk by faith. Sometimes I don't feel like I'm saved, but I know that I still got a gap filler standing between me and my enemy. The devil's on my trail, but he's got to come through God first. The devil's on our trail, but he's got to come through our Savior. Thank God I'm sheltered, and I'm under the feathers of the Almighty. There's no pestilence that shall come nigh my dwelling, because he's Almighty God. Praise God. Amen to God. You ask anybody in here, they've all felt the same way. And I said, when you don't feel like you're making ground, you're making better ground than you realize. Because you're pressing and you're praying and you're loving the Lord. And through these trials and through these dry times, we begin to find out how great and how awesome our God is. He's with us through every trial of life, through every situation. And right when you're least expected, the Holy Ghost is going to show up and bless you and shout you and minister to you. Because when you think he's not there, he's right around you. Because he's your gap filler. Praise God. Hey. Hallelujah. Bible says in Psalms 125 and 1, they that trust in the Lord shall be as Mount Zion, which cannot be removed but abided forever. As the mountains are round about Jerusalem, so the Lord is round about his people from henceforth, even forever. Amen. I don't know. I've never been to Jerusalem, but evidently you can go there and turn around and see the mountains all around Jerusalem. It must be in the valley. I don't know. I haven't been there. As some of these priests said, I've been there 27 times. Well, I wish I had some of your money to get there, because I've never been there. But I'm here to tell you, as the mountains are round about Jerusalem, amen, so are the Lord. How campeth around about thee, Amen to God. He's all around his church. He's all around his people. And it's time for God's people to lift up their heads and realize, hey, God's standing between me and my devil. And I believe I'm just going to stop and I'm just going to shout and say, devil, you can't touch me because I've got God between me and you. I'm a saved individual, and you've got to come through God to touch me or my church or my home or my family, because God has made up the gap. Yeah. Praise God. Yeah. Hallelujah. Zechariah 2 and 4. And 5 says, and saith unto him, run, speak this young man, say, Jerusalem shall be inhabited as towns without walls for the multitude of men and cattle thereof. Sometimes we feel like we're just sitting ducks and don't have no fortification. We don't have no walls. That's what, amen, Nehemiah wrote around Jerusalem, looking, said the walls lay desolate. We have no fortification from our enemies. We are living in this rubbish, in this rebel. But I'm here to tell you, the verse 5 says, for I, saith the Lord, will be unto her a wall of fire around about, and will be the glory in the midst of her. I'm here to tell you, as Christians, we don't have no walls of fortification to, amen, withhold the enemy. We don't build walls with brick and mortar. We don't build walls, amen to God, with concrete. We don't pour concrete slabs and walls. But things belong to God. We've got one that is around about us, amen, as walls of fire. Sometimes it's walls of prayer. Sometimes it's walls of grace. Sometimes it's walls of fire. But I'm glad that God campeth around about his people. He said the angels of the Lord encampeth around about them that fear and love God. I'm here to tell you, friend, he'll be your hedge. He'll be your gap. He'll save your family. He'll save your soul. And God has called us all to be gap fillers. So we see that God is our great gap filler between us and our enemy. And how much more should God's people be gap fillers for one another? You think about quitting? You can't quit. You're a gap filler. You think about backsliding and giving up, throwing in the towel? You can't, because you're a gap filler. You thinking about quit coming to church, quit being faithful? It's just not worth the fight. I promise you it's worth the fight, because when we get there, we're going to be glad we held on. You can't quit because somebody's watching you. You may be holding your family together. Amen to God. I can't quit now because I've got too many children hearing daddy preach for 25 years. And if I turn around now, what confidence will they have in the church? What confidence will they have in preachers? What confidence will they have in one another? I'm going to tell you, we've got too much to gain to lose. We can't stop now. We've got to keep on keeping on. We've got to keep on fighting because we are gap fillers. Your family depends upon you. Oh, Brother Harold Bush come to me one day. We was praying inside the prayer rooms. He said, Brother Vogan, sometimes I feel like quitting. Amen. He'd been in church a whole lot longer than I was. I'd been there a few years. He says, Brother Vogan, sometimes I feel like quitting. He said, but something stands up in me, says, you can't. Your family's counting on you. Your family's looking at you. I'm here to tell you, you can't get weary with well doing. You can't quit. You are your gap filler between your children and hell. You are the gap filler between your children and hell. You are the gap filler between this world and hell. And it's time for somebody to say, hey, I realize my place. I might not be a pulpit preacher. I might not be a Sunday school teacher. But you got a greater importance being a gap filler, being a light, being a prayer warrior. Amen. Holding on to God for somebody else that may don't go to hell.
He said, I sought for one and I found none, just for one to make up the hedge and fill the gap for his land. A lot of times we run our country down and it's done enough wrong. We run our church down and it's done enough wrong. But God ain't looking for people to be running stuff down. He's looking for some gap fillers to make up the hedge and fill the gap for our church, all our 10 denomination, and never come back. Thank God we're still trying to do something right. Thank God there's still some holiness churches in our organization. Thank God there's still some preachers I can call. Thank God there's still somebody I can have confidence in. But I'm going to tell you, hey, listen, we can be a gap filler. We can maintain and we can shine the light. We can hold the hedge up. I said, you know, devil, you're trying to break it down for many years, but God forbid we should let you break the hedge and run through and cause a gap in our ranks. We're going to keep on holding on and fight this good fight of faith and build, amen, be a gap filler. When one old timer dies, oh, somebody else needs to stand up and fill that gap. Amen. Sometimes our churches go through loss because those that got their victory die one by one. But God's looking for some young people to get full of the Holy Ghost and said, I'll step up. I'll fill the gap. I'll make up the difference. I'll get a hold of God. I got mama going to hell. I got sisters backslid. I got family laws. I'll fill up the hedge and make the gap. Woo! Thank God for those that are willing to be gap fillers. Abraham was a great gap filler. His nephew went to Sodom, chose the fertile plains of Jordan, chose the wrong way. A lot of times we see families choose the wrong way and we give up. Say, well, they deserve it. Ha, 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 ha. But I'm here to tell you, we've got to be like Uncle Abraham was. God, don't destroy the city. God, have mercy on the land. I mean, there is homosexuality in the city, but Abraham said, God, if there's 50 righteous, will you not spare the city for 50 righteous? Oh, oh, they deserve to die. They're a bunch of pedophiles, whoremongers, perverts. But Abraham had the mind of God because he was a friend of God and said, God, for 50 righteous, will you not spare the city? And then he pleaded that much more because God didn't hide it from his friend and said, hey, friend, we're fixing to go down and destroy Sodom and you know Lot's down there. Abraham said, Lord, there's 45. Went down to 10. Will you not spare the city? Then there wasn't even 10, and I believe that Abraham had to pray then for Lot. God, will you get Lot out if you're not going to spare the city? God, don't let my nephew die and go to hell. I know his wife and his children pulled him down. I know his wife and his children pulled him to the side. I know he's lost his children's confidence because he let his wife water him down. Don't let, amen, Lot go to hell. God, will you please spare Lot? He stood in and filled the gap and prayed for his nephew. You've got family dying and going to hell. They may be in deep, dark sin, but can you not stand up and say, I will fill the gap and be an intercessor and pray that my family don't go to hell? I don't care how deep and how dark their sin is, your prayer still touches God. Amen. Woo! Hallelujah. Sometimes we're too self-centered to fill a gap, too full of unbelief and lack of compassion to fill a gap. But I'm here to tell you the greatest call anybody could have is to say, I'm not a preacher, but I'm a gap filler. Stand in the gap. Yes. Pray for my son. Pray for my daughter. Pray for my neighbors. Pray for my friends. Pray for my church. Pray for my country. Why? Because I'm a gap filler. I'm between them and God. They can't pray, but I can.